It's good to see everybody here tonight. Thank you for coming out. You're in for a treat tonight. Dr. Kent Walters is the director of the Cornerstone Chorale in Michigan. And this is a Christian college, and it's kind of an interdenominational college. So we're an interdenominational church, so it's kind of neat to be here tonight. You're in for a treat. You know, many of you here come in here, the chamber choir sing, or the violin chamber singers. And we pay, how much do we pay for that? $25 or something like that? Well, this group is as good as the violin chamber. So when the offering plate is passed, let's be very generous, okay? And we want to give them the biggest offering that they have received on the floor. And I know y'all can do that. So, I'm not putting any pressure on you, but I know. And it's going for a good cause. So, with that, I want to introduce to you the Cornerstone Chorale.
Thank you. You can tell Don's taller than I am. Thank you to Reverend Don Edwards and to Amelia Island Plantation Chapel for this welcome. It's a great delight to be here. I've anticipated coming here. I come to Jacksonville twice a year, but I also teach at the Robert Webber Institute for Worship Studies. I have friends, many friends that have come here and visited here. Of course, Dr. Jim Hart from the Institute has been involved in this ministry, and then Terry Schroeder, Dr. Schroeder from the past as well. So some wonderful connections here. So I'm so delighted to be here. And this is an absolutely gorgeous space to worship God. Especially when it's daylight, right? We walked in this afternoon and we were just enveloped in the sacred space of nature and the sacred space of this chapel. And we just said, thanks be to God. So we're just going to have fun singing again tonight. You get to listen in while we worship God and give Him praise. Did you all get a concert program when you came in? I know the greeters were so hospitable at the door to pass those out. If you didn't get one, I bet if you raise your hand, one will magically or suddenly appear. Okay, good, I'm so glad. Because you need some of the translations. The next piece we're going to sing is this setting of the entire psalm, Psalm 96 in Latin. Magnificent song of praise. You may want to find it along the text. A unique musical setting by the Estonian composer Harvard Kent.
Thank you.
The next two pieces on the program present for us a stark contrast, both textually and musically. In fact, I've programmed these two pieces as an intentional juxtaposition of the Song of the Soul. The first one is quite horrendous. From the Book of the Lamentations of Jeremiah, Jeremiah writes in the Book of Lamentations of the fall, destruction of Jerusalem in 586 B.C. at the hands of Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians. It's a horrific poem, as he explains famine, starvation, disease, death, even cannibalism. Mothers eating their own children. It's horrific. And the prophet writes, all the people who pass by, look and see, have you ever seen such anguish as ours? Have you ever seen anything so horrible? The children of Israel had turned their backs on God, and God, in his justice, was sending them into captivity. And the Holy Land was becoming a ruinous wasteland. That horrible scene is juxtaposed by the second piece, which is the setting of Psalm 121. The delightful psalm that the Jews sang for centuries as they would come up to Jerusalem three times a year for the feasts. They said, I lift my eyes to the hills, from whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The translation of that piece is also in your program. Horror and hope. Terror and trust. Pain and promise. Kind of sounds like real life, doesn't it?
I'm sorry. Thank you.
And of course, you know the source of that hymn text, right? That hymn is based on scripture and it comes from what book? Lamentations. In the midst of the sorrow and the pain, his mercies are new every morning. And the prophet Jeremiah could see that by faith in the midst of the challenge and the difficulty. That's why we claim ourselves as the one of the promise, isn't that true? Despite what we're going through? The next three pieces will close the first half of our program, and they are songs on the Incarnation. The Incarnation is very important theology for believers. The Incarnation, the Incarnos, God taking on carnality, is significant for the faith story of those who follow God. God became what he created. God became what he made. He took on human flesh so that he might die and become the Redeemer for all humankind. Thanks be to God. We celebrate that with three different angles and three different styles. The first one is a spiritual, and it simply tells the gospel story. See that babe that I'm going to manger? He's going to take all my sin away. See that babe I'm going to manger? One of these days, he's going to reign with my God in glory. One of these days goes from the manger to the throne of God. The second piece is in Russian, and it picks up the story after the birth of the baby Jesus, when Mary and Joseph, in faithfulness to the law, took Jesus to the temple at a time of purification to dedicate them to the Lord to offer their sacrifice. And the prophet Simeon, who was alive, of course, when Jesus was born, was promised that he would not die until he laid eyes on Messiah, the hope of Israel. And so he lingered in the temple, in the temple courts, waiting to see Messiah. When Mary and Joseph brought him in, he took the baby Jesus in his arms. You remember the story? And he said, Lord, now let your servant, me, depart in peace that we have. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have made clear to all humankind. A light to the Gentiles, who are in darkness, by the way. And the glory, the glory of God the Father and the glory of his people Israel. The translations in the program. Then the third one picks up the angle of the story a bit later when the Magi come. But in this piece is Spanish. The Magi are coming to lead the parade to the baby Jesus in Lima, Peru. It's an African-Peruvian community to which they come. And it's a great celebration. The translation isn't there because it's a pretty convoluted poem, so they didn't put it all in. But they bring gifts to the Lord. Sweet cakes and pancakes and sweet water, all from the good. And the Godmother and the Godfather comes. That's a missing part of the story that we don't read about in the Bible. Because it's true. It's a great part of what they're doing. They're doing a proof in this celebration, right? And it's a great festival as the kings come, Gaspar, Melchior, and Balthazar. They come and they come into the presence of the king. And what do when you come into the presence of royalty? Not quite sure. You must. Of course, you must die.
Thank you.
Takes a really great to catch the breath after all that bowing. I want to take just a moment to tell you a little bit about Cornerstone University. And I think the best way to do that is to have a student help us. Why don't we stand in the light? This is for the lectern normally, so we can be at the lectern. Cornerstone University, as Reverend Edwards was saying, is a Christian liberal arts college. There are a couple of pages in your program that will introduce the university to you if you've not heard of it before. He also mentioned we're in Grand Rapids, Michigan. For this morning, there was another one of those things we call a blizzard. And so my wife tells me that all the schools are closed again. And Gilbert Assemblist had a picture from her daughter in the driveway with a drift over the top of the driveway. And we're saying, you know, here we are in Florida. And thank you, Jesus. It's been a tight winter. You know, the polar vortex. Maybe you haven't heard of that. I stopped my ears up to that as well. You know, just let those northerners deal with that. Anyway, other than that, it's a lovely place, especially in the summer. Cornerstone University is a person of a lot of talent, and here's what we're committed to. Two things. Giving our students an academically rigorous education. You need to work hard and earn a degree that they can be proud of, that will equip them to do the work of the kingdom, God's kingdom. Secondly, we're equally committed to forming them as disciples of Jesus Christ. So we challenge them in many different ways, inside and outside of the classroom, to listen to the voice of God and to build the life that matters. And the life that matters is the life that's committed to Jesus Christ, the Savior and Lord. And be excellent what you do across your field, whether you are studying to be in the ministry in one way or another, which is possible at Cornerstone University and at our seminary, or to our professional graduate school or some more business-related degrees. We recognize that all the kingdom of God is all the kingdom of God, and we need followers of Jesus in every field and every discipline. So, I'd like you to meet one of our students. Emma, tell us your full name, where you're from, and what you're studying.
Hi, everybody. My name is Emma Fitchfield. I'm from Traverse City, Michigan, which, believe it or not, is even colder than Grand Rapids, Michigan. I'm a junior at Cornerstone, and I'm studying psychology.
So you're studying psychology, and you can tell by the program that not quite just over half of the students in the trial are music majors. But that means a large percentage are not music majors. That's because they studied music, sang in choirs in high school, played in the bands in high school, had a musical experience in high school that gave them the chops to be able to audition into a group like this, often with a scholarship, by the way, and be able to have those kinds of musical experience in undergraduate life. So as a psychology major, where do you see your career path leading you? We're really big about talking about life calling, aren't we? And having a career calling that matches our lives, finding out who we are, what we love. And our professors and even my private department can even just helping students find out who they are so they can pick a major that is a reflection of what they love to do, because you really want to be in the career that you love the rest of your life, right? Sometimes a parent says, you don't need to be an engineer. And the student goes into engineering and they say, well, I really hate this major. I really want you to be a biological scientist or something like that. But we just try to help them listen to God to find a way to that. So having said that, where do you see the Lord leading you with a psychology degree?
So after I graduate Cornerstone, I will be going to grad school to get my master's in counseling. I'm also getting a music minor through Cornerstone, and so what that means for me is that I hope that once I have my own counseling practice one day, that I'll be able to implement art and music therapy into my practice.
That's really intriguing. So we talked about Cornerstone being a Christian community. What aspect of the Christian nature of Cornerstone has been meaningful for you, Emma?
So I was actually a transfer student, and I transferred to Cornerstone my second year of college. And one thing that I noticed right away was the staff and faculty of Cornerstone. They are so committed to not only investing in your education and your spiritual walk and your spiritual journey as well. And so for me, just being at Cornerstone, having people who are intentionally investing into my life has been very, very influential just in my walk with Christ.
Let's thank Emma for sharing her life path. Do you have any Cornerstone graduates, or those who attended Cornerstone, or other various names over the years since 1933 when it was founded? Anyone in the audience that went to Cornerstone? If so, we have some valuable gifts to give to you. Oh, there are several of them now, yes. All right. How many of you have never heard of Cornerstone before tonight? Okay, well, a good number of you. I'm so happy to be able to introduce the school to you. Let me say a little bit about our tour. Last Thursday morning at 5:30 a.m., we met on the campus, got into vans, and went to the airport and began our concert tour. We had our first concert Thursday night at Grace Anglican Church, Fleming Island, where Jim Hart is one of the music directors. and continued from there to St. Simon's Island in Georgia, to Orlando, to Tampa and Clearwater, but I toes into the White Sands on the golf course and coast in the Clearwater, and our course then here today. And you can see from the program where we will go from here, at Jacksonville tomorrow night, St. Augustine, and then we end the whole tour in Fort Lauderdale. 12 days of tour. And next year, as you also can see in the program, we are anticipating a little bit more strenuous of a trip, at least as it relates to time zone changes. 12 hours ahead of us, we will arrive in Asia next May, where we will concentrate in Singapore, Hong Kong, and Mongolia. All of that is really possible because of my relationship with students and graduates at the Institute of Worship Studies. I have students and graduates that teach and serve in all those countries. And so, just as a big opportunity to come here because of my relationship with Don, whom I met at IWS, it's a great opportunity for us. So, thanks for your prayers for that. If you are so ready to be in prayer for us, you just send an email to music@cornerstone.edu. And just say, here's my email address, add it. And we have just under 300 people on a personal prayer list for just prayer. No other prayer list, the university will never see it. I'm the only one that sees it, because I'm the only one that sends out that prayer letter. So if you have a prayer list, we would be honored. And thank you, Don, for mentioning the offering and the $25 that each of you is going to put in that offering tonight. I was really inspired by that. Let me just tell you what that offering will go for. The students paid for their airfare. They all paid for their own airfare down here. And so we too are offering, we're raising money to pay for the bus. And then for whatever else we receive in the offerings beyond paying for the bus, we'll go toward our Asia trip next year. You say, how much does the bus cost? The bus costs us $1,170 a day. Just under $1,200 a day, times 12. You can figure out the math on that. So I'll just say that to you to give you some idea of what our expenses are while we're into it. And other things that we have done that has been so generous and responsive. And I thank you in advance for your kindness as well. And for your prayers for us as we go. So the ushers will come as Craig is going to return. And as they sing a song of praise, you may worship God and you'll be honored. Thank you.
I will rejoice. Thank you. Thank you.
Three songs fit with prayers. Psalm 142, that my prayer lies with incense. Abide with me, and this is your grace. We go from the throne room to the nursery room. There's a switch. But I think moms know that the nursery room is a place of prayer as well, right? A lot of prayers in the nursery. A lot of prayers for the little ones. And sometimes, perhaps, the nursery rhymes themselves. Some of them are like prayers. Prayers of a playful sort. The next two pieces in our program are the second two pieces of contrast. We began the concert with contrast and the devastation in 586 BC Jerusalem with the hope of Psalm 121. And now we turn to a horrific story of a time in our country's history around the Civil War that was equally horrendous. Great God Almighty is the story of a slave master chasing his slave with the intention of beating him to death. It's a story of hatred. It's a story of savage injustice. It's a story of murder. And quite frankly, I wouldn't program this piece in a concert for years when I was introduced to this piece, because I could never find a concert venue and a concert context that would be appropriate to share that horrible story. Until preparing this concert tour and thinking about the importance of contrasts that you've already heard tonight, in the importance of us looking at the ugliness of ourselves, of the world, and the beauty of God in Jesus Christ. There will always be ugliness. There will always be redemption. We were introduced on Friday to the story of Neptune Small when we were on St. Simon's Island. Neptune was a slave on the Butler King plantation. A beneficent master, if you will, such that Neptune really wanted to serve as the manslave of this master. And he did. He planted many of the trees that lined that pathway toward what was the plantation mansion back then. Now it's an exclusive golf course. And when Butler was called in to serve the Confederate Army, Neptune said, "I'm going with you in the battle." Neptune wanted to serve him even in battle. They went north. Butler was killed in the state of Maryland. They'd been separated. Neptune searched and searched for him. Came upon a body of corpses. Began to pull those corpses apart, one after another, looking for Butler. He had red hair. He identified his hero, pulled his corpse from that pile of bodies, and carried him back to Georgia and buried him on his plantation. They've honored Neptune. They gave him property. Neptune Park now honors his life, his service, his sacrifice. Sounds a lot like Jesus. We honor him, Neptune Small, as we sing this song tonight. We honor everyone who has faced injustice of slavery, hatred, and murder. But we follow that horrible story with a magnificent 19th century hymn, where the hymn writer says, "Sweet rivers of delight, I see just people in our lives. It's the sweet rivers of redemption, the sweet rivers that take me to the next land." And in the midst of pain, whatever your pain may be, whatever your horror, whatever you face, whatever baggage you drag in life because of the circumstances that you have to live through, now there is hope of sweet words that one day will make it worth it all, because Jesus paid it all.
Mighty, 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 m Thank you.
Tonight with a song from the African continent. I think we will find on that Jesu. Very simple text. You see it, of course, translated in your program. But even though it originated in South Africa, it is known across the African continent. I know it to be true because we have students at Cornerstone University from several African continents, as well as at the Institute for Worship Studies. And when they mentioned this song, or when they heard us sing this song on campus, they said, "We know this song. We sing this song back home. We sing this in Nigeria. We sing this in Sierra Leone. We sing this in Ghana." It's wonderful that it has that kind of universal appeal and expression. It simply says, there is no one like Jesus. There is no one like Jesus. We walk, we turn, we search. There is no one like Jesus. Thank you for coming tonight. Be pleased with this great profound statement.
Thank you. Oh,
I don't think I've ever heard a choir quite like that. They were beautiful, weren't they? They brought the glory of God down to us, and we thank you for that. The ones that are housing the students, if you'll just stay in here, and we'll get you signed up to get you set up with the students.